The season is finally over. The Derek Betts were eliminated in Game 6 of the National League Championship Series by the Los Angeles Dodgers, 10-5. Is the end of a truly magical, wonderful season, one of my favorite of all time. A season I will fondly look back on and remember as being the season that no one expected. No one did. And they rode that magic as long as they could. They had one last bit in Game 5. Game 6, I was hoping that they had a little bit more left in the tank and it could get them over the hump, but unfortunately, the season's over. Really, really, really incredible season. I can't say enough. And we're going to talk about what was a tough performance today. I would like everyone to look back at how great some of the players that struggled in this game were all season. But we have to do our final sort of breakdown of the season, and then we look forward to looking past the World Series into the off season for the New York Mets and what potentially may be coming. It's another thing that we'll be talking about tonight. This is gonna be kind of tough to talk about. It's still very raw, if you're like me, if you are a Met fan, you feel that this is sort of the season that you wanted to sort of believe in and get to experience a little bit of that World Series magic also, but no such luck. We are going home, but we're not going home sad. We are going home happy, and we still love our team. Roll the music. Hello, welcome to Mox Mets Podcast. I'm your host, Mike Shoda, and a happy, well, not really so happy, but let's say happy Sunday, everybody. This was kind of a gut punch watching this game, which was started off promising. There was a Met run scored thanks to some chicanery with a little bloop hit from Pete Alonso that would score Francisco Lindor in the first inning. However, Sean Manaea unfortunately just did not have anything in this game, and I want to be angry at Manaea, but I'm not. He pitched terrific for this team the entire season, and it was said by John Smoltz, who was doing color commentary for the Fox Sports broadcast for this game, and he's been doing it for the entire postseason. But Smoltz pointed out, he did point out that Sean Manaea had been, he had thrown an enormous amount of innings, over 180 innings plus the postseason starts, and it was a career high for Manaea. He had never thrown that many innings before in his career. And Manaea himself had pointed out that he kind of hit a wall in his last start, where he, after 80 pitches, he just couldn't really get anybody out at that point, and he ran into problems. It was very similar at the end of his last start, Game 2, to this start in Game 6, and you could see he was not comfortable on the mound. He was struggling with his stuff, which was excellent all season and very effective, but had a lot of trouble, and particularly with Tommy Edman, who was named NLCS MVP for the NLCS. So this was the mostly Edman in this game. Edman would drive in 4 runs by himself and was excellent all series. I mean, he was really very effective for the Dodgers, as was everybody. There was Ohtani got his hits in, as did Teoscar Hernandez, who had been ice cold in the series. Everybody on the Dodgers was coming through with some big hits. Ultimately finishing with, I believe it was 10, oh no, 11. Sorry, 11 base hits for the game. For the Mets, we got one more blast from Mark Vientos, who came through in a big way in the top of the fourth with a 2-run home run that would score Francisco Alvarez. Alvarez would get a sac fly to give the Mets cut the lead down to 4-7 in the top of the seventh, and it was fairly close at that point. But unfortunately, lands at the bottom of the eighth, and that's when Kode Senga unfortunately was unable to replicate his success from the seventh inning. Senga had been brought in the seventh, pitched well, but clearly in the eighth inning, he just he everything kind of came off the wheels at that point, and it was a Mookie Betts once again. Betts coming through in a big way, hitting a RBI double that would increase the lead to 8-4, and then Teoscar Hernandez getting a sac fly, tying 4, and then Kiki Hernandez, who's done a lot in this series as well, coming away with the RBI single, and that's 10-4, and they had a sizable lead at that point. And if you're a Met fan, you're watching that ninth inning, and you're like, I wonder if they could come back from 6 runs down, very quickly. Jesse Winker was out, Starling Marte was out, and we're down to 2 outs. But that never say die attitude from the Mets still existed, even in a unwinnable situation. Tyrone Taylor coming away with a bloop single. He would advance to second base, and then Jeff McNeil would drive him in with an RBI single to give them the Mets a 10-5 lead. And you can see McNeil, he was just happy to kind of contribute in this game. Getting that base hit, I'm sure it felt great for him. McNeil had a very interesting season, a terrible first half, but a terrific second half, and then unfortunately had that injury where and it led to him not being able to contribute to the Mets' postseason run. But he became available later in that game in the series, and it did lead to some pleasant moments, particularly when because Jose Iglesias had just gone ice cold in the playoffs, and we didn't see any Iglesias sightings in as of late. He's been he has not been available. He's off the bench, but he no, with no Iglesias available, it did feel like the team kind of was missing one of their leaders. Iglesias was there in spirit, but it did feel like, oh well, we've kind of lost one of our guys who's such a big contributor to the team. There's undeniably Iglesias was one of the 5 most important players of the Mets this season, and he, if not just from his offensive and defensive value that he brought, but also from his from a clubhouse perspective, he was an enormous unifying figure, a veteran who was able to speak to basically everybody, and everybody wanted to see succeed. And OMG became obviously a huge thing for the Mets. It became their sort of their signature of the season, and it will go down as the OMG season. It will also go down as a lot of other things. This was the season of the gimmicks that just kept on going. It was gimmick, 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 starting with the rally pimp in April, and then moving its way to the grimace in June, and then we had. We're not going to mention her, but you know who I'm talking about. And then finally, the Pete's Magic Pumpkin, who was such a big thing for the Mets in the postseason. That was the postseason pumpkin was a fun bit also. And but undeniably, this will go down as the OMG season. This is it was a big thing. It was a season where We heard that OMG music being played all the time. I have I've been had ads to my playlist for a long time now. It's just been an incredible anthem, and I think it's going to be something that's going to stick around for the Mets going forward. I don't know what their plans are to do with Iglesias. He came over in a on a it was a minor league signing. They didn't expect him to really be any kind of major contributor to the team other than as a utility infielder. And he became basically indispensable for the Mets down the stretch. He was such a huge contributor for the team. And I would very much like to see him come back. I hope they would bring him back just for even for nothing else other than just the vibes. I think that would be an important thing to keep him around for in that case. But yeah, there's going to be a lot of questions about what the Mets are going to be doing for the remainder of this for the off season. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But just a last moratorium on this Mets season. It was an amazing season for Francisco Lindor. Lindor got a hit in this game and got on base twice, base hit and a walk. You could see in from the Mets approach in this game, they just didn't have quite the same magic as they did in Game 5. Game 5, no strikeouts. Game 6, quite a few. So 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 strikeouts in total. And the swings and misses, I mean, particularly in this was a bullpen game for the Dodgers. This was pretty tough to watch. The Mets just struggle, and not struggle per se. I mean, they scored 5 runs and on had 11 base hits, but blew some major chances, and there was a bases loaded situation that could have potentially tied the game midway through. So that was one thing that kind of blew up for the Mets there in that case. And then it did, it there were a few situations where they just struggled to get guys in from base. And you could see the Brandon Nimmo, he just didn't have anything left at that point. The foot injury really kind of seemed to sap it from him, and he struggled a lot. Vientos came through with a 2-run home run. Pete Alonso had a couple of base hits in this one. Jesse Winker was 1-for-3. Starlin Marte, such a huge piece of this team from the postseason. Maybe their hottest hitter other than Mark Vientos. And he was 0-for-5 in this win. Tyrone Taylor was 2-for-4. I mentioned the base hit he had in the ninth. McNeil was 2-for-5, and Francisco Alvarez kept his high hitting up from the last game, and had a couple base hits also. So the Mets were getting base hits. It's just they couldn't function in the offense to score enough runs in this case, and the Dodgers were just relentless is a terrific word to describe them. They were. It just felt like they were constantly getting guys on base, and then they would just be leadoff men on, and you can't let that happen with the Dodgers. I mean, it's gonna be very interesting to watch in the World Series, but because they're gonna be facing the New York Yankees, a team I feel like got like such an easy ride into the World Series facing the Royals and the Guardians, and really haven't faced like one significant opponent on their ride in. And this is it was kind of felt very fortuitous that the Yankees were going to be set up into the postseason. It was just a matter of who's going to be the Mets or the Dodgers. You're going to have great storylines either way. If it's the Dodgers, you have the number one seed, Shohei Ohtani, the likely National League MVP facing the likely American League MVP, New York Yankees, Aaron Judge. Yankees are also a one seed, so you have this great matchup, and the Yankees and Dodgers having so much history as well. So there's that, and of course with the Mets, Yankee, it would have been epic to watch 24 years later another Subway Series, one where two teams that no one probably would have expected to be in the World Series facing each other. That would have been fabulous to watch, but no such luck. And so we are on our way, and I do think the Dodgers should win that World Series handily. I think they are a very difficult opponent, and pretty hot right now. I mean, like you have to look at their offense in this series, and the Mets pitching was not effective really in this one for the most part. There was some, there were obviously games where they pitched a little bit better than others, but I mean, it was just blowouts all the time. And you look at the amount of runs that were scored in this series, it was just a lot of offense. So if there's one concern for the Dodgers is that their pitching just wasn't really that great. And in this one, there are a lot of questions about about the Dodgers pitching staff and whether or not they can take on that Yankees team. But I think there's no question the Dodgers lineup is far more intimidating, even with the success that Soto and Judge and Stanton have been having on the Yankees. So it's gonna be interesting to watch that series. Back to the Mets, though. There were a few things I wanted to mention. This was Vientos obviously played terrific. He sets the record for most RBIs by a Met in the postseason, in a single postseason performance. He was fantastic. This was very much the validation series, sorry, validation postseason for Vientos, who had a great year. And there's going to be a lot of questions about him entering the postseason, whether or not he was going to be an effective contributor. He very much was. Vientos was everywhere this entire postseason and was just doing it. And he did it again, another two-run home run in this game. And I think the Dodgers saw their fill of Vientos for a while, that they would not want to face him again. He's terrific. I think he's going to be a consistent member of this lineup, middle of the order hitter for the foreseeable future. Him and Lindor, and it's certainly going to be some question about what they're going to position around those two guys. But those two guys are terrific hitters, and Lindor obviously it was an amazing season for Lindor, who very much will deserve any MVP consideration that he should get. I do think Ohtani will win it easily, but Lindor should make it semi-interesting to watch. And it's been fun. It's been a really wild ride. I'm kind of I'm emotional. It's been just like I'm kind of glad it's over. I just can't. I've just been focused on this series for and the Mets postseason for so long. It's just been sort of just agonizing, like day in, day out. You didn't know if this team was going to win or not, and it would win, but then they would also lose, and it was a lot of just like restless nights and bad dreams. A lot of games, a lot of days I woke up where I was dreaming like the Mets were losing postseason games, and I would have to remind myself that the game hadn't started yet. So that was I'm kind of glad that it's over in some sense. I'm happy that we can kind of like put this to bed. I do think the Mets did deserve to be in it here. I mean, no one can take it away from them that what they accomplished. This wasn't a just a something of, oh well, they got hot. Oh well, they just happened to hit right their right moment. They maintained an incredible performance over the course of several months, and kept that momentum going into the playoffs. It was very difficult. We saw that just the they were burned out by the end of it. It was an incredible task that they undertook, and for them to get all the way to the Game 6 of the NLCS, fantastic. And it's just this series was just like another in the legacy of many Dodger postseason battles that they've had, and it was really fantastic to watch. It was a great series. I mean, I certainly would prefer better pitching in the series, but it was from an offensive standpoint, obviously fantastic. Looking forward to the off season now. We are going to be paying a lot of attention to some major free agents, guys who could potentially impact the starting rotation, guys like potentially a Corbin Burns. If the Mets can lure him over, maybe somebody like him, and also possibly Blake Snell is another name that's been floated around as a potential addition to the starting rotation. And then we also, of course, have the Soto watch, which is going to be the thing on everyone's mind, whether or not the Yankees can re-sign Soto, and if not, we would assume that his first look is going over to the New York Mets. I'm not I had this conversation with my brother yesterday, and it was about whether or not the Mets could potentially sign Soto, and that my brother theorized that it seemed more likely that Soto was just going to follow the paycheck. He wasn't really interested in staying wherever it was. I do think it looks like, if you've gone this way, you've gotten this far with one team, and now you're in the World Series. I think it sometimes does feel like you're like, okay, well, I feel obligated to stay here, and the Yankees will cut him a very big check, I assume. But there is also some question as to how much they can actually afford. I mean, they paid George Judge an exorbitant amount of money, and so they have Gerrit Cole still signed, and there's a lot of stuff that they have to do. They still have Stanton's contract and all these like giant contracts that are cluttering their payroll. They're already paying an enormous amount of money. So if they're actually even able to sign Soto, I mean that the it's not going to be easy for them to do so. So it there is a chance the Mets come in and poach him. I don't know what that would mean for if they're spending that much money on Soto, which is going to be like somewhere in the neighborhood of most people assume $50 million a year, unless they defer a lot of his money like the Dodgers did with Ohtani. It does seem more and more like they would have to do something to that effect in order to make it work from payroll perspective. And if they do, it would be a great move because I think everyone kind of looked at what LA did, and it was a lot of acquisitions, bring people in, and a lot of deferring the Ohtani salary so that they could do it, bring it so that they could sign Yamamoto and all these moves that the Dodgers undertook. So you would probably look at them as an example as how you're going to do it, especially if you have these like major free agents like Burns and Soto who could be huge additions to this team. Then there's also the question of can you bring the core of this team back? The core of this team obviously extremely important, and you want to maintain the guys who did great for the starting rotation, starting with Sean Manaea, who didn't pitch great in this game, but was excellent for the team the entire season, including the postseason. And Manaea was, you look at him, you're like, that guy has something figured out and would be a very effective rotation piece. There's also the question of re-signing Luis Severino, also bringing back, I think, Jesse Winker and Jose Iglesias, as I mentioned before. Winker was excellent for this team and did a lot for them, especially in that Game 5 win, but also in the postseason. He contributed in major ways. I think he's a really good role player for this team. And then you also have the big one, which is Pete Alonso. And can they re-sign Alonso? And Pete had a postseason that he really needed to have, which was coming through in a lot of big clutch situations, was going to be the major question with Pete. He certainly accomplished everything that he needed to do. It came through with those huge home runs, and of course the wild card game, but also during the Philly series and then in this series, contributing as well. So he had a really good postseason. It's a great establishing performance for him coming off a sort of middling year, regular season wise. So it is a question of whether or not they can bring him back or if they want to bring him back. If it was Pete's last game. We certainly loved what he did for us in this postseason. He came through in a lot of major ways and was such a huge part of this team's success in the postseason. So we can't ever forget how big a contributor he was to this team. So there are a lot of things that we are going to be continuing to monitor now that the 2024 is no more, and we can focus our eyes and look at 2025, and maybe this is a year where we can kind of take 2024 and what we did in this season, where they definitely hit on a formula. They definitely know that the clubhouse is a major thing. They need to know that it is not just the how much you're paying the people that you have playing for you. It's also that they contribute and are people who contribute to a positive and unifying atmosphere in the clubhouse. Because once they did that, once they made the moves that they did, you can look at the Jorge Lopez thing and removing him, and then also them kind of clearing the air with the team meeting in June. All these were just like major things that it became known and clear to not just the players, but also the organization in total, in that they knew that they needed to bring these guys and make sure that they stayed together, because once they were kind of all on the same page, everything just clicked into place, and they seem to have found that kind of mix to it. And Lindor's obviously a huge folk hero now. I mean, like, but he was still hearing it like earlier this year. Like, there was a lot of people who were calling for his head, and they're saying that this guy was overrated. Those people, you can't find them now. They have gone very far underground. So Lindor is such a huge piece of this team, and is his legacy as a Met star, one of their best players ever, very much intact. He's had an amazing performance for him, and it's now about, can we add on to this? Can we make this even better? Because this team won 89 games, and truthfully, if they gotten off to a better start, they might have won like somewhere in the neighborhood of 98, 99 games. That's how good they were. They were the best team in baseball, from what was it? Sometime in June, because June 15th, June 16th, somewhere around there, that was the sort of like the turning point for them. And you can go all the way back to the series against the Phillies that they had in London. That was sort of the turnaround point when they won that crazy game two, and it just kind of all kind of fell apart for the Phillies from that point on, and then all kind of came together for the Mets at the same time. So, it is sort of the thing that you never know when you have it, and when they realize that they had it, you're like, whoa, okay, this team actually has major legs. They have something to them, and it just got crazier and crazier and crazier. And then these last like 3 weeks were just insane. From the end of September, that very last game in September where they had to beat the Atlanta Braves in a doubleheader, and like from that point on, it was just nuts. It was just one crazy moment after the other, and knocking off the Brewers, knocking off the Phillies, taking the Dodgers to six games. It was nuts. It was crazy. I still look at it now as being this crazy, crazy year that I almost don't believe happened, still in somewhat, but it's so special. And like I said in my intro, that this was one of my favorite teams ever. It was so good. It was such an amazing thing happening. Every day you felt like you were going to watch something special, and Lindor was a huge part of it, and Alonso was a big part of it, and we get the shout out guys that weren't didn't seem like huge parts of it, but they were. Alvarez, as much as he struggled, he was also a huge boon to that pitching rotation. I think they really respond to him. He's such a huge piece of that in that way, even when he was struggling offensively. We're hoping that he can come back and hit the way that we know he can hit in 2025. But there's that, and then you have Jeff McNeil, who struggles also really badly in that first half of the season, and then was red hot. He was so hot in the second half of the season, and then Vientos became a huge contributor. Brandon Nimmo was the guy who was just always around, and he was playing through an injury, never easy. And I do feel like they just didn't have a better option than him, or else they probably would have rested him. But this team was kind of on its last legs, sort of in that stretch. They were playing on fumes, and you could kind of tell in this game that they were just didn't have quite enough left in them. But the fact that they still fought, they kept fighting until the end, was really wonderful to see. This was an amazing performance, and even in the loss, which I'm still going to be kind of bitter about for the next couple of days, I will look back very fondly on what was an amazing season, and I hope more is to come. I hope more. I just hope more. I hope. I hope we have not only scratched the surface of what can potentially be, not just a miracle team, a team that no came from nowhere, but also a good team. And that is the next challenge for this organization is, okay, now we had an amazing season. let's build on this. Now let's build ourselves into a contender. Let's make sure we make the right moves. Let's not just go after the expensive guys. We also need to make sure that we go after the right guys. And I think we have now a team president in David Stearns who can execute that in the way that they want to. Certainly people will look at Stearns as sort of a whisperer now, as the guy who kind of brought these pieces in when no one really expected him to, and it just kind of worked for him. And so they're going to look at him and say, okay, so whatever you want to do here, we're going to support you. And it really was an amazing season. I cannot say enough about how wonderful it was to see the Mets in the postseason again, and not just in the postseason, like succeeding, winning series, and getting as far as they did. It was fantastic. What an incredible year. We loved you 2024, and now we look to 2025. So thank you very much to the New York Mets for an amazing, fun, drama filled season that really captured the imagination and love of New York Mets fans, and really the city itself. I think everybody is going to look back on this season as simply amazing. So thank you very much again. We love you, New York Mets. All Mets fans love you. I love you. Let's go Mets. LFGM. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you for listening to Mike's Mets Podcast. Please be sure to follow us on Spotify and subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. Finally, please also follow the podcast Twitter, which is Mike's Mets Pod, all one word. Appreciate your time and have a wonderful rest of your day or evening. Let's go, Mets.